Well, let's dig in. I'm going to stay in a Sermon on the Mount, but I want to change this series title to Law and Grace, if I can, because the next section of Matthew chapter 5, we're going to get into a lot of law and a lot of grace. If I can give you kind of an introduction to what I'm going to say, if you want to turn in your Bible to Matthew chapter 5, these three verses are the most important verses in the Sermon on the Mount. 17, 18, 19, and 20 are the heart and the key verses of the whole thing. Okay? Because what Jesus is going to do, he's going to lay out the gospel, but he's going to lay the gospel out in the way that the Jew of that day would understand it. For us, we might not quite get what they would have gotten 2,000 years ago when they said it. Matthew chapter 5, this is a great section, so let's just take some time this morning and begin a subject of law and grace. Not law and order. I love that TV show, Special Victims Unit. One of my favorite TV shows. But let's look at law and grace. I want to give you a perspective, if I can, going into this, because it's difficult for us, if not impossible for us, to transport ourselves back in time 2,000 years ago to the day when this was written. It's also difficult for us to understand a Jewish culture in which it was given, because we don't live in that kind of culture today. So it's very difficult for us to understand these verses. It would have been simple for those in that day to pick it up because they lived in that culture and Jesus spoke to that culture in that day. But it's still as relevant for us today, and truth is truth, whatever culture, whatever time span we're talking, truth does not change because time changes. Truth is the one thing that never changes, and everything else does. So I want to give you a perspective. You like my picture? Oh, you like that. This is what it looked like in Jesus' day. This is the temple. Okay? If you ever travel to Israel, you'll go by this display. This you can see the people standing in the background on the display there, so you can see this is miniature. But this is a setup, and this is one person saying, this is what Jerusalem in the time of Jesus looked like. And that, of course, center is the temple, okay? So you have that setting, that's what it looked like. Jesus comes along and says, this whole thing is coming down. Not one stone will be left on another. Right? Yeah, how do you think that message went over? How do you like change? How do you process change and how do you handle change? This is the generation that had to process it more than anybody because he said that whole thing is coming down. I'm going to rip it apart. Now you know why they crucified him? You get that? If I would come in here and tell you, in my ministry, this whole church is coming down, well, there won't be one stone left on another, I'd be crucified too, right? Well, you may not kill me, but you may run me out of here. Correct? Come on. Right? Okay. Just to give you a perspective, Jesus said this, Matthew 24, here it is. Jesus left the temple, so you just saw the temple right there. Okay, that's where he was. He leaves the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up to him to call his attention to its buildings. Look at its buildings. Okay, see them all? Do you see all these things? What things? Right there. Jesus said, truly I tell you, not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down. Right there. That's all coming down. I'm tearing that all down. How do you think that message went over? Not very well. Not very well. And just so you understand this, this is what he's saying in his inaugural speech. Okay? What he's going to do, and I'm going to show you this, he's going to take them through a shift from the old covenant to the new covenant. You need to understand that in your theology because the Bible speaks in terms of covenants. The Mosaic covenant, the Noahic covenant, and now we come to the new covenant. And the basic difference is this. The old covenant was blood of animals. The new covenant is the blood of Jesus. The old covenant was written on stone. Remember, Moses came off the mountain, it was written on stone, tablets of stone. Remember that? Remember that? The new covenant is written on hearts. Totally different. The old covenant was a shadow of things to come. The new covenant was a substance. The old covenant was glorious. The new covenant is more glorious. And you can read the rest of those. But you just get a feel that Jesus came and Jesus said this, just so you know, I came to tear that down. Inaugural speech. Radical change. So radical, they crucified him. Okay? All right, I'm trying to give you, you see that perspective? So you understand that his inaugural speech, he's signaling where we're going. He's telling them what we're going to do. In essence, he says, I'm going to drain the swamp. No, I'm going to tear the swamp down. You understand how right? I'm not taking a political side here. I'm saying when you start messing with the swamp, people don't like that. We're seeing that in our day. One guy in there trying to drain a swamp, and everybody's trying to protect the swamp. So you have exactly the same thing. Get that perspective going into this, all right? Jesus was coming to change it. So how many of you hate change? Don't raise your hand. Most people hate change, except for air conditioning. We like that. Okay. I just had to throw that in there. You'll forgive me, won't you? Okay, you got the perspective? The new and better covenant. It's called the New Testament. The word testament and covenant are identical, exchangeable words. So you know that, right? Jesus is setting up a covenant. It's called the New Covenant. Jeremiah 31 tells about it. Now, as we get into this, Jesus says this. This is, so you know, these verses are the most important verses in the Sermon on the Mount. Verse 20 is the key verse in the whole Sermon on the Mount. Okay? He says this. Do not think I've come to abolish the law and the prophets. I did not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. There's a difference. He said, for truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, and you know when that'll be? It's like, you don't have to worry about that. Not the smallest letter, or not the least stroke of the pen, a jot or a tittle, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. I didn't come to destroy it. I came to fulfill it. I am, in essence, he's saying, standing before them, I am the fulfillment of the law. That's what he's saying. And those verses bear that out, correct? You with me? Okay? Therefore, anyone, you know who anyone is? Anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commandments and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commandments will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Okay. And then he says this, for I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and of the teachers of the law, the scribes, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. Get it? See it? How do you like to be a Pharisee listening to this message? How would you like to be a scribe hearing this? Gentle Jesus just poked them right in the eyes as hard as he could. He hit them hard. He basically says, you guys ain't getting into the kingdom of heaven. This was no Sunday school picnic speech. Jesus is no coward. The first thing he says in his inaugural address is this. All of you listening, if your righteousness does not exceed that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you're not getting into my kingdom. In other words, what he's saying is the scribes and the Pharisees aren't getting into my kingdom. How's that for loving? How's that for gentle? See it? You got the perspective? So I'm ripping down your temple. I'm changing it. And if your righteousness doesn't exceed their righteousness, you can't get in. Yeah, popularity went where? He just drained. This speech is saying this. I've come to drain the swamp. Sorry. You don't even know who I voted for, so don't get excited, okay? But you're seeing parallels in our time. Jesus was very, very pointed. He didn't mess around. He cut it straight. These are the most important verses in the Sermon on the Mount because he presents here his agenda and really summarized here in a way that the Jewish people 2,000 years ago understood. Here's the gospel. Here's the gospel. It's presented in these verses. So I want to take with you today, and I want to give you some truths, if I can. I need my phone, wife. My PowerPoint did not transfer over. Jeff, I'm not sure why I'm not backing up now. Every now and then it happens. He who relies on technology dies by technology, right? All right, I'm going to walk you through it. You're not going to see it, but I'm going to give it to you, okay? The first truth is this. There's three truths in this passage of Scripture I want you to get. Let me see if I got it again. Had it on there yesterday. It's not there, Jeff. Okay, I'm going to put these three truths up there because here's what I want to talk to you about, okay? The first truth is this. In verses 17 and 18, Jesus came to fulfill the law because we could not. Okay? We could not fulfill it. Now, in that, go back to the old-fashioned way and open your Bible. Let me get to Matthew chapter 5 here and show you this, okay? Jesus says this, "Do not think I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them. I came to fulfill them." Okay? "For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of the pen will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished." What Jesus is saying to this group of people, and they got this. It's not as clear to us because we're 2,000 years out. But here's what they got. I came to fulfill the law. I came to keep the law because you could not. You haven't. Beginning at the Garden of Eden, they could not. Man could not. When the Garden of Eden, when man was created, he said, "Don't eat of that tree." Guess what we did? Went and ate of the tree. That was one commandment. We couldn't have one. Now Jesus comes and gives 10 commandments, and he says to us, "You could not keep these commandments. The reason I have come is this. I came to fulfill the law." I want you to understand the law demands perfection, which we are incapable of giving. Pick any of the 10 commandments. You shall not steal. Any of us guilty? You shall not bear false witness. And you can go on and on. Every one of these commandments we have broken. In fact, all 10 we have broken. If we sat down and carefully analyzed our lives, or anybody sat down and carefully analyzed their lives, every one of the Ten Commandments we would be guilty of violating at some point and at some time in our life. So Jesus arrives and he says, look, I didn't come to get rid of that. I came to keep it. And I came to fulfill it so that when you looked at the life of Jesus, this is what you would have said. He kept every one of them. All the commandments, all 10 of those Mosaic commandments that were given, Jesus kept every single one of them and he lived them out perfectly. He's saying this, here's why I came. I came because you were incapable of fulfilling the law. I'm capable. I'm here to save you. I'm here to rescue you. That's the message of the cross, okay? That's the message of Jesus. And what he's doing at the very beginning of his ministry, he's simply laying it out for them. Now, what he says, secondly, is here, this is, so we get, in verses 17 and 18, you see his mission. And what you see is he is stating the reason and the purpose for which he came to earth. And it's really simple. I came to rescue you from the law. Why? Because the law does this. The law condemns every one of us. Think of it this way. Someday when we stand before God, which everyone will, whether they want to, think they are or not, everyone is going to stand before God. Everyone. And everyone is going to give account of their life. When we stand before God, or people stand before God, what God is going to do is God is going to take out the law and he's going to go through the law with people. And as he goes through the law with people, every person standing before God is going to have to say, guilty, 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 guilty on 10 counts. And that's not good because it's going to condemn. And Jesus steps in and says, I fulfilled that for them. I am their Savior. I rescue. So as God reads the law to us, Christ steps in our place. And when God looks, he doesn't see us who broke the law. He sees Christ who fulfilled the law standing in our place. That's called salvation. We just got saved from our condemnation at that point. So what Jesus is doing at the very beginning of his ministry is he is saying, here's why I came. I came to fulfill the law because you couldn't do it. Now, the second truth up here is this. The law is God's measuring stick and always will be because it reflects the nature and the character of God. God always uses the law to judge. Every person, everything gets judged on the basis of who God is, not who we are. What we do is we keep changing the law, okay? We want to keep changing the law. And the other thing we tend to do is this. If I want to look at things and I want to make myself look good, I know who I should look at to make me look good. Well, look at them. Look at that person over there. I'm better than that. Okay. Well, look at this guy over here. I'm not that bad. That's how we do it. Okay. That's why when you go to the cross, the reason there were three guys hung on at the cross when Jesus died, the reason there were three, okay, and it's because you saw an example here of all the different excuses that people make. The one guy crawled out and said, truly, you are the Son of God, but the other guy never did. And when you get to the cross, we try to say, I'm that, I'm this, I'm that. But the truth of the matter is all of us are judged on the basis of who God is recorded in the law. And at that point, I can't, but I was better than my neighbor, but I was better than, were you as good as God? And all of us have to say what? No. So understand this, God never sets aside the law. If he, to set aside the law, he has to set aside who he is because the law is the revelation of who God is and it is the perfect revelation of his character. It is the best description of God. He does not steal, he does not bear false witness, all of that, that's God. And that's why we can't measure up, because we're not God. So it's a revelation of his holiness. So you have to understand what he's saying is this. Guys, the law sticks. I've not come to do away with the law. But in fact, he says, if you try and change one of those laws, he said, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commandments and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. You can't set, well, I didn't do that. And that's what the Pharisees did. I'm not that bad. When we're stood next to God, guess what we're all going to look like? That's why they crucified Christ and released Barabbas. Barabbas made them all look good because they weren't that bad. He was a serial killer, murderer, the worst in the day. They released him because he made them look good. They crucified Christ because he made them all look bad. And understand, the law is God's measuring stick. He doesn't set it aside. He can't set it aside because the law is the description of who he is. Get that? All right, let's go to the third point. The third point that Jesus makes here is interesting is this. Self-righteousness will not get you into God's kingdom. Okay. And he says, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, guess what? You can't get in. Now, what he just said was this. Think that through. What he said was, hey, scribes and hey, Pharisees, guess what? He basically says to the scribes and the Pharisees, you guys are going to hell. Okay. How do you think that went over? Okay. So all that you've done, all their, and they were basically about this. They were about morality. Okay. Picked up a book about a month ago, 2 months ago, that said this. Sunday school is killing our kids. Is Sunday school the reason we're losing so many kids from our church? It's an interesting book if you want to read it, okay? You can get it on Amazon. Is Sunday school killing our church? And the answer was yes. And here's what it said. It said because we taught our kids to be moral. Moralism is one of the main reasons kids are leaving the church today. There's two things that have caused kids to leave our churches today. Okay, one is we legalized the gospel. Two is we moralized the gospel. Instead of teaching our kids that you're sinners in need of a savior, we tried to teach them to be good kids. Makes sense? Okay, now that sounds terrible to say, doesn't it? But the Pharisees were trying to be this. They were trying to be good, moral people. And Jesus said, you guys are not getting into my kingdom. And he says to the crowd standing there, if your righteousness does not exceed their righteousness, you can't get into the kingdom of heaven. So moralism and legalism are the two things that are deadly to a church. Two things absolutely deadly to our lives. And that's why it's important for us to say this. Paul said it this way. The Apostle Paul, if he stood before you, he would say this, I am chief of sinners. That's what Paul said. Right? In other words, if Paul came in and we introduced him, we'd want to stand up and we'd say this, hey, we got the biggest sinner today that is going to be our speaker for our service this morning. He has committed more sin than any of you. And the sins that he has committed, he is guilty of murder. He was an accessory to the murder of Stephen. And our speaker today is guilty of murder. He's guilty of this and he's guilty of that. He's a horrible man. And he's going to give us the message today. You're all excited to have the Apostle Paul with you today. And Paul would walk up and say, everything that guy just said about me in this introduction, I got to tell you, it's worse. It's worse. I'm a worse sinner than you can imagine. We don't think in those terms, do we? We don't think in those terms. we would introduce the Apostle Paul as, man, we got the greatest apostle with us today, phenomenal speaker, reached this, saw evangelism take place, saw all kind of stuff take place, saw this, saw that. Man, this guy is unbelievable. He's living a Christian life that's far beyond any of us, and he's a pattern and a model for us to follow. That's how we'd introduce him, isn't it? And we're thrilled to have with us today the Apostle Paul to speak. We'd moralize him. And Paul would get up and say, that's the worst introduction to me ever heard. I want to tell you, I'm guilty of murder. I am the chief of sinners. And if it were not for a Savior, I would be in such desperate straits today. I'd be destined straight to hell. As moral as I was keeping the law. I was a Pharisee. I did all that stuff. Everything. We would moralize them. But the truth is, we moralize ourselves. And we moralize our churches. And what we need to realize is, sitting here today are sinners in need of a Savior who kept the law. Let me introduce to you today all of you who broke the law and continue to break the law on a regular and consistent basis. Let me introduce to you the person who never broke the law, Jesus Christ himself. Kept it perfectly. Guys, he's sharing the gospel in this verse. Verse 20 is the key verse in the whole Sermon on the Mount. Okay? It's the key verse in the Sermon on the Mount. Unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you can't get into heaven. He's telling them how to get into the kingdom of God. He's giving them information about how you can't get in, and he's telling them directly how you can't get in. You won't get in if you're this. The antithesis of that is you can get in if your righteousness exceeds them. Well, how in the world can our righteousness exceed them? Get a Savior. Get a Savior. Your Savior's righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, judged by the law, because the Ten Commandments, the moral law that they kept, tried to keep, okay, he kept it. He did it. He did it for us. He did it because we couldn't do it. And so when I stand before you today, I stand before you today. If you know the thoughts that went through my head this week, you'd throw me out of here. If you knew some of the things I thought this week, you would get rid of me. I'm not going to stand before you and say I'm not going to stand before you and throw moralism at you. I'm going to throw this at you. I am chief of sinners, but there is a Savior who rescues sinners. And I'm going to proclaim this message. I stink, but Jesus is really good. Jesus can rescue you. Jesus did for you what you could not do for yourself. And he did it in a couple of ways. He did it, first of all, by living out the life you could not live. And he did it, secondly, by dying the death that you should have died. And I should have died. And I would all I would do is say, hey, let's stand and sing together. Hallelujah, what a Savior. He rescued me. He rescued me. Why? Because I'm the chief of sinners. But how many of us, when we walk out the door today, walk out the door with the thinking and the feeling in this way, oh man, I stink. No, we want to come to our churches and we want to get this feel good about ourselves. No. There's nothing about ourselves that we can make ourselves feel good. But when we talk about our Savior, now we not only feel good, but we are good. Why? Because he was good in my place. He took my place. He is my substitute. He is my Savior. That's it. See it? That's the church. That's the church. The church is all together. When we all get to heaven, we're all going to stand with Paul and say, we were horrible sinners. The best of us. Somebody's calling me. Sorry, that's funny. No, I vibrate back there. hope you get this. We as a church are not about morality, although we strive to keep the law. We as a church are not about legalism. We understand the place of the law. We as a church, and you especially as a church, because you named it Grace Bible Church, we're about grace. And grace is giving to you what you do not deserve. And that's our story. That's our story. We don't like to think that way. We like to think in terms of we're good, moral, upstanding people. That's how we like to see ourselves. And in comparison to some other people in our culture, we are good, moral, upstanding people, depending who you compare yourself to, right? But when we all compare ourselves to Jesus, we're not so good, are we? We're not so good. But it's okay that I'm not so good, because he's good for me. That doesn't mean I go out and I try to sin and I just sin all I want. I don't try to do that. I don't have to try. I try not to and still do. Does that frustrate you? And then I just run to God and beg God, God, cleanse me. Thank you for your purity, and thank you for your cleanness, because your cleanness is my cleanness and your purity is my purity. And I just want people to know we have a great Savior, and Jesus in these verses of Scripture is, he in essence is crucifying the Pharisees, and he's exalting the law and saying, I came to do this for you. That's what these verses say. This is the most important thing he says in this opening statement. Now, let me get back to this, and let me finish it out. So the truths are this. In his inaugural, Jesus' inaugural speech condemns the religious sects in power. Great. You know, I think there's much about Donald Trump I can't stand. But I think as he there's some parallels to some of this, because as he tries to drain the swamp you can see. So it does give you a little bit of a picture of what it was like when Jesus came and tried to drain the swamp of the religious leaders of his day. And what the religious leaders of his day did was they crucified him. And what are the political leaders of our day doing today? The parallels are really fascinating, and I don't care what party you are. But Jesus basically says this: you get to heaven by the righteousness of Jesus, not by your own. Not by your own. So as you go out there this week and you try to live righteously and you try to live in obedience to God, which you should, which all of us should, and which we will, I'm going to do my dead level best this week to live in obedience to the Word of God. Okay? Because that's holiness. Holiness is living in obedience to God's Word. I'm going to do my dead level best to do this. But when I hit that point where I have a thought that flows through my head that should never flow through my head, it's okay, because that thought never flowed through Jesus' head, and he's my Savior. He stands in my place. That's what we have to understand. So what we proclaim as a church is we proclaim both law and grace. We can't get rid of the law. Jesus said, if anyone tries to get rid of the least of these commandments, don't do that. We point to the one who fulfilled the law. Now, let me just, in winding this up, if you have a Bible or your telephone or you want to go there, turn with me to Hebrews chapter 9. Let me just show you a couple verses. In Hebrews chapter 9 and 10, it talks extensively about the old covenant and the new covenant. And I don't have the verses marked here. I think it's verse 1 and 2, I think. It says this. Now the first covenant had regulations for worship and also an earthly sanctuary. Okay? Let me show that. Look up here. It had an earthly sanctuary. That's it. Jesus' day. That's what he was referring to. Okay? So, as he... When Hebrews, whoever the author of Hebrews writes, he says, now the first covenant had regulations for worship. And you know those regulations. If you committed this sin, you brought this sacrifice, right? I told you this before. I'm glad I didn't live in the Old Testament because I would have come carrying sheep, goat, bird, pigeon, and all that. And I had a whole flock coming behind me. You would have looked at me and said, oh, man, you had a bad week, huh? I didn't look at the guy that's coming with a pigeon and say, hey, good week, huh? Yeah, I only need a pigeon to sacrifice this week. But the first covenant had regulations for worship and also had an earthly sanctuary. Watch this. A tabernacle was set up. In its first room were the lampstand and the table with its consecrated bread. This was called the holy place. Now, I'm going to jump, and I don't have the verses down. I'm going to jump to a couple verses down. It says this, but when Christ came as high priest of the good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made with human hands, that is to say, is not part of this creation. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and of calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. So what happens today is this. In that day, they set that up, what you see up here, okay? In this day, he put the Holy Spirit in you. You are that. Jesus fulfilled that. And that's why he took that down, because he raised you up. What? Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, and you are no longer your own? You have been bought with a price. You are the temple of the living God. Jesus replaced that with you. That's the new covenant. That's amazing, isn't it? Let me show you one more verse in chapter 9. I don't have the verses written on this, so I'm not sure of them, but it says this. For this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. And then go over to chapter 10, about halfway down, is some of the greatest verses in all the Bible. Again, I don't have the verses marked here, so you have to dig them out as I read them. But there's a phrase that starts like this. This is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. Listen, I will put my laws in their hearts and I will write them on their minds. So instead of tablets that Moses came down that had the law on there, it's you. It's you. So, don't take this wrong, but if our country tears down, takes away all of the Ten Commandments and the places where it's put up, and don't take this wrong. It's okay, because you say the same thing and more. Because the new covenant is written in your hearts and in your minds. You are those tablets. That's you. That's the new covenant. We say, then he goes on and he says this. Listen to this. Then he adds, their sins and lawless acts, the transgressions. Sins are falling short. So sins are the times you didn't measure up. And lawless acts are the times you violated the what was there. So he got you on both. He got you on both accounts. He's got what you fell short of doing. You didn't do that you should have done, and he's got you on the side of you did what you shouldn't have done. Their sins and their lawless acts, I will remember no more. And everybody in here said what? Amen. Hallelujah. Here's what I love most about this verse, okay? In my life, as I get older, I find I forget stuff. In fact, I'm at the point where I live in the hereafter. And those of you that get that understand what I mean, okay? You walk into the kitchen, you stand there, and you say, what am I here after? Okay? I forget. I want you to understand this. Jesus and God doesn't forget anything. He makes a deliberate decision here not to remember it. And there's a difference. There's a difference between forgetfulness and deliberately setting it aside. So what Jesus says to all of you is this. All those lawless things that you're going to do this week, what lawless deeds did you do this week? Boy, I don't remember them. I don't remember them. You tell me you did that? I don't remember that. I don't remember that at all. Isn't that amazing? That's the new covenant. So you look at your past, you can't forget it, right? God doesn't remember it. In fact, he said it this way, as far as the east is from the west, so far have I removed your sins. And those of you that understand north, east, south, and west, understand that if you go north, you eventually hit south. And when you go south, you eventually hit north. But when you go east, you never hit west. He didn't say, as far as the north is from the south, so have I removed your sin. He said, as far as the east is from the west, I've removed your sins. East and west never meet. That's how far your sins are removed. And that's the new covenant. Do I forget them? No. Someday I will. Someday God will take our memory and just wipe it clean. But I can't forget them. You ask this interesting question on top of that. Then if that's true, why does he have us confess our sins? Why does he say in 1 John 1:9, if we'll confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us. Why does he do that if he doesn't even remember it? Why does he ask us to confess it? Simply put, for your benefit, not his. Because he wants you to deal with those issues of your life that need to be dealt with. From his perspective, you did what? What did you do? I don't remember. I'm glad of this. I'm glad that I was born this side of the cross. Not that side of the cross. I'm glad I didn't have to bring pigeons, ducks, birds, lambs, goats, sheep. Because I would have kept my dad busy raising goats and sheep and all that, birds. Or I would have had to go and say, Dad, I need a couple of bucks. I got to buy a couple of pigeons this week. What did you do? I'm glad I don't live that side of the cross. I'm glad that when I come into the presence of our gracious Father and confess my sin, he says, thanks. You're good. But I don't remember it. I chose to block it out of my mind. That's our Savior. So we're not here to present morality. We're not here to present legalism. We've been through that. Most of you that have been around the church have been through legalism and been through moralism. We don't want to throw out the law. We want to exalt the Savior who kept the law for us. That's what we do. So do I tell my story? Yeah, I'll tell you my story. I'll tell you a story of rescue. Because I wasn't so good. But Jesus is really great. Get it?